Hello and welcome to tonight's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After, the picture e-book. Preparing for the Day After is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight we will study the various lessons learned from search and rescue missions in disaster-struck landscapes. Let us first recap what we have learned in the previous book reading sessions before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Livelihoods based on local agrometeorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Culture-sensitive food security also has evolved out of local agrometeorological conditions prevalent in an area. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene, especially for indigenous women, solid waste management, universal health care access, sustainable development goals, they are all factors to be included in the development agenda. Media personnel have to be trained in disaster preparedness reporting or the lack of disaster preparedness at the district level. Disaster is the impact of calamity on the human landscape. This includes the impact on lives, livelihoods, livestock, and landscape. Among the calamities that warrant professional training for search and rescue in India are avalanches, blizzards, cloudbursts, coastal incursion, cyclones, climate change, floods, forest fires, fog, hailstorms, landslides, mudslides, sandstorms, storm surge, storms, squalls, thunderstorms, urban floods. Among the man-made disasters are aviation disasters, building collapses, hijackings, industrial disasters, multi-vehicle road and other highway accidents, pogroms, shipping disasters, terrorism, train accidents, and urban infernos. Migration on account of conflict is rampant in South Asia, in Pakistan, Afghanistan, Sri Lanka, Nepal, and Myanmar. In India, migration is largely because of ecological issues, construction of dams, mining, etc. Dealing with poignancy, now I will start off with the remaining part of the search and rescue and the role of the military in search and rescue. That chapter will be concluded today, so I'm reverting to the book reading now. Recalling with poignancy a very touchy humane situation, General Anil Chait emphasizes the necessity of sensitive management of human emotions and leadership. There was a situation which was reported to me, he says, that a civilian had been found near a valley base. But even after repeated requests by the armed forces personnel, he was not willing to be evacuated. Sensing the criticality, I reached by a helicopter to a nearby helipad and walked down for about 45 minutes to reach that person. I saw him sitting close to the bodies of his dead parents, wife and children. It was a very sensitive situation. I spoke to him about his loss and then asked him to move with us. He refused, point blank. I spent some more time with him, trying to persuade him to agree and move with us as it was getting dark. He was silent, speaking in monotones, dumbstruck by his loss and not ready to leave the place. Finally, I could manage to open him up a little when he said, "Sir, where should I go? For what do I need to go or live? You see these bodies here? These are my parents, my wife and my children." And there, looking at the distance towards the Kedarnath shrine, he said, "There is my God to whom I had come to pray. From where should I go from here?" He was asking me a rhetorical question about purpose of life and its utility. It was a delicate, heartbreaking and most difficult moment for me to convince this person to move. Having vented out his feelings, he sobered a little. We slowly helped him to his feet and moved up to the helipad and evacuated him to Dehradun, from where I ensured that he went back to his remaining family members earliest. Successful military operations in the 21st century will be amongst people, says General Chait. These will require flexibility and a wider range of capabilities. The armed forces exist to serve people which it has sworn to defend, protect national interests and support and defend the Constitution. While bearing our responsibilities and discharging our assigned tasks, it is incumbent upon us to adhere to moral values and ethics in keeping with the highest traditions of services. I am confident that the men in uniform will overcome the challenges to infuse, permeate, and consolidate the bedrock of these virtues, notwithstanding the evolving nature of culture, values, beliefs, and the norms of society. Our citizenry and leaders also has to support the military profession in developing these values and ethos and nurture these by giving due izzat or respect as military seeks to establish a unique subculture that distinguishes its practitioners from the society they serve, even while supporting and enhancing that society. Such a subculture has at its core a set of cardinal moral principles, values and beliefs which enables setting of standards of performance and code of ethics to maintain their efficacy. The challenge for the military leadership is how to infuse, permeate and consolidate the bedrock of these virtues, notwithstanding the evolving nature of culture, values, beliefs and norms of society, says General Chaith, drawing up on the experience of paramilitary forces' participation in disaster mitigation efforts. Today, in the remote Andaman Nicobar Islands, the Indian Air Force personnel in Karnik, Navy personnel and Coast Guard personnel in Campbell Bay and Kamortha are ever ready for evacuation at short notice with all the infrastructure support they can muster. Military trucks are the first line of preparedness in the remote island chain. In the one decade after the Asian tsunami, with a successful run of an accurate tsunami forecast on the 11th of April 2012, India can share its success of preparedness. Regular mock drills, testing of early warning signals and equipment in the chain of command has left the island administration confident of facing the next tsunami. It is almost saying, apart from a tsunami, no other natural calamity will ever strike the Andaman Nicobar Islands. The armed forces' primary duty is to defend the country's sovereignty and integrity, causes Bell. In a written statement released to me for a clarification I sought for military debris being dumped on the ocean floor as target practice on mute wildlife, the Indian Navy had said in March 2011, and I quote, "In an era where the chances of outbreak of hostilities stemming from any one of number of possible causes Bell, including the repeat of the terrorist attacks in Mumbai by state-sponsored non-state actors, the necessity for the Indian Armed Forces to remain combat ready at all times can hardly be overemphasized." So that doesn't justify target practice against mute wildlife, does it? In recognition of the responsibility of defense forces to the country's sovereignty, it should be spared obligations of disaster mitigation. The civilian administration ought to be disciplined and trained, further held accountable too. That is also in the interest of robust democratic functioning. For often administrative management augments a natural disaster like the June 2014 Bias River drowning of 24 students from Andhra Pradesh in Himachal Pradesh. It is thus judicious and right to train the National Disaster Response Force in lieu of deployment of armed forces in search and rescue or in humanitarian assistance and disaster relief operations. The island administration of Andaman Nicobar Islands has not even bothered to document the geological after effects of the mega earthquake and the tsunami, much less taken measures to face the impact of geological after effects of the tsunami in the geologically volatile Andaman Nicobar Islands. In one of my articles, I have written about the opening up or the possibilities of geological consequences of the mega earthquake and tsunami. I have provided one of the links in the description box below. In this chapter, we have learned of the diverse duties and challenges posed by Mother Nature. There is a need to train our armed forces, or better still, our administration, including battalions of the National Disaster Response Force, about responses to hydrometeorological and hydrogeological natural calamities. I wish some institutes of learning does a case study to analyze logistics of these operations. It simply cannot be comprehended or fathomed by the layman on the street, says General Chaith, recalling his experience of search and rescue in Uttarakhand. Disaster management should be an academic discipline in all universities, institutes of learning and research institutes, as well as in training institutes. By doing so, we can at least start to come to grips with the situation before responding to the might of Mother Nature. General Chait said, the armed forces provide assistance to the civil administration as per the guidelines in the Ministry of Defense manual on instructions to armed forces for aid to civil authorities. Formally and legally, the district magistrate or the district commissioner can requisition the armed forces for dealing with such contingencies when the situation is beyond the control or coping capacity of the civil administration. Lessons to be learned. Let us try and recap the lessons to be learned from the role of military in search and rescue. Foremost in importance is a clear-cut sharing of authority with civilian government. A democratically elected government must seek the military's role in writing or as per established practice and standard operating procedure to complete search and rescue. This is of critical importance to ensure that the military hands back the reins of governance or administration to a popularly elected government and civil administration, lest it tantamounts to military rule and dictatorship. If the military has to get into search and rescue, then the civilian administration has to at least shed their lethargic bureaucracy and respond complementarily. The onus of coordination has to be with the civilian administration. Putting up an electronic bulletin board or a missing persons registry has to be done by the police department. Enormous amount of bandwidth has to be made available both for survivors and the civilian administration, as well as for search and rescue teams. During peacetime, when there is no disaster, the military search and rescue teams might as well be deployed for areas where the civil administration has absolutely no competence, like search and rescue of asylum seekers on the high seas, for example, or anti-piracy operations. Intelligence inputs, including forecasting, actionable inputs from intelligence services, scientific forecasting, mock drills, transparent governance, and standard operation procedures should all be part of a wider perspective for disaster management. Upgrading equipment and training, publicizing standard operating procedures are all very important. Culture-sensitive community kitchens or disaster preparedness have to be all in place. Evacuation infrastructure can be upgraded depending on the requisites revealed by mock drills. Infrastructure preparedness has to be ecologically sustainable. There should be infrastructure options too, as in Plan B infrastructure should include alternatives if a particular port or a wharf is damaged. Make sure that there is another pier or a jetty that can be operationalized. Infrastructure should also be planned for differently abled persons or people with impaired mobility. Infrastructure should also be planned for shipping livestock and to provide veterinary care. CNG installed crematoria has to be set up in every taluk of every district in India. This helps mitigate emissions and mitigate climate change. Multipurpose disaster shelters proportionate to the population of every village must be established in every village. Infrastructure preparedness includes scientific and other installations like lighthouses. Among the scientific installations, need for a role of military in search and rescue mention may be made of satellites, radars, buoys, drones, helicopters, winches, harnesses, night vision lights, laser beams, tree cutters, steel cutters, bulldozers, welding machines, air ambulances, tents, sleeping bags, clothing donations, excavation machines, drilling machines, boring machines, and a whole lot of more, or a whole lot more of equipment. Included in today's video is a whole slideshow on search and rescue equipment. It comes at the end. Medical preparedness must include mental health interventions like counseling. Disaster preparedness must include addressing the needs of visually and hearing impaired people, as well as people living with mental health issues. Currently, disaster risk reduction thought revolves around caregivers or people living with mental health issues being addressed and trained. That is the only solution for disaster preparedness for people living with mental health issues at present. A person living with manic depressive psychosis or schizophrenia or bipolar disorder needs the tutelage and sensibility shared with him or her. Similarly, child psychologists have to be present while interacting with a child survivor. Apart from mitigating impact of livelihoods and landscape, we are in need of specially trained forces to mitigate the impact and injury to livestock and wildlife. When terrain changes, wildlife too are displaced. In fact, in today's report, I've seen a crocodile taking a walk in the town of Dandeli in Karnataka. They are often displaced because of floods. I mean, any kind of zoo wild animals are displaced because of breach of their containing their spaces, etc. Water treatment plants have to be installed to treat sewage. Desalination plants have to be installed to cater to the needs of 1,000 people dotting the landscape, especially in coastal areas where there is an acute water crisis. Youth task forces have to be entrusted with volunteering to supplement the duties of other authorities. Supply chain infrastructure, cold storage and ecologically friendly barns must be installed in every village of every taluk in every district of India. Mitigating rural malnutrition and maternal mortality are pressing needs. Immediately after completion of search and rescue, fumigation and other sanitization measures have to be undertaken on a war footing. Interpreters and translator services are necessary in multilingual India for a whole spectrum of issues to be served efficiently. Communication infrastructure must include wireless sets, landline telephones, satellite telephony, mobile telephones, internet communication and bandwidth. All kinds of chatting apps, submarine internet cables, 500 terabytes of bandwidth on a per capita basis are necessary. Yeah. That is all for tonight. Please don't forget to tune in for the live interaction at 7:30 p.m. Indian time, Saturday, 3rd of July, 2021. Please be so kind as to share this video in your circles. If you have not yet subscribed to our YouTube channel, please do so now without further delay. If you can and if you will, please do give it a like on our YouTube page. It matters because we are trying to start a webcasting series on disaster mitigation. I hope this episode on search and rescue will give you an in-depth insight into the search and rescue of the military in disaster-struck landscapes. That is all for today, and in next week's video, we shall meet with survivors of the Asian tsunami. Believe me, it will be an incredibly touching narrative. Not sure how many videos will make that chapter, but trust me, you will be very, very touched. So, I'm looking forward to interacting with you all in the live interaction on Saturday, 3rd of July. Until then, I shall take leave. You take care, keep smiling, be safe, stay home. Ciao, take care, bye. Well, I'll have to wait for the slideshow on the military to continue. I will take leave, but that will continue.